गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, माय नेम इज डॉक्टर गौरव. स्टिल एकोइंग.
ओ गौरव, योर प्रेजेंटेशन इज म्यूटेड ना, बट
सर जेजेम सर, इज योर मोबाइल ऑन?
Sir has also got two. Jagmohan sir has also got two
icons.
One doesn't have the microphone,
but still it will interfere. Oh, sir,
my laptop doesn't have a microphone,
but the you are able to hear on it, so that echoes.
Okay, then I'll switch off my microphone. When I come for questioning, I'll on it.
No.
Okay, sir.
I'll first listen to Gaurav.
Let's see now.
All right, sir. Go to the presentation.
Yeah, Gaurav.
Yes, sir. But this is a case that has been given to me. Chief complaints: a 33-year-old male resident of Cochin came with the complaints of difficulty in walking and slippage of footwear from the left foot, concomitant of difficulty in movements at the left ankle of 6 years duration. Sorry. History of presenting illness: a patient had sustained an RTA in 2014 with the resultant fracture of the left tibia, for which an open reduction internal fixation was performed. And since then, he has complaints of difficulty in walking with a gait in which he is unable to clear the foot from the ground while walking and has to incorporate the use of his knee and hip to aid in his walking. No history of any other injuries in the accident. I do not have a history regarding the fracture site and the whether it is a bilateral, whether it is both bone fracture of the lower limb, whether it is a compound fracture. The only details I have is that it is a left tibia fracture that was operated. There is no history of smoking, alcoholism or any tobacco addiction, no history of diabetes, no history of hypertension, no history of any other previous surgeries other than the open reduction internal fixation for the left tibia performed in 2014, 6 years ago. General physical examination: patient is a young male, moderately built and nourished. Patient is alert, conscious, cooperative and well oriented to time, place and person. There are no features that are suggestive of pallor, ichthyosis, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy or edema. Vital signs with respect to the blood pressure, heart rate, respiratory rate and saturation are all within normal limits. He is afebrile. Systemic examination: it is not significant to the present condition, so I shall not elaborate on it. This is the picture that has been given to me. I will discuss this picture, prior to which I just want to have an examination in general to the patient, where I would like to examine the patient in four, that is standing position, sitting position, supine and while walking. I would like to examine the patient in the standing position, and I notice that the foot is flat on the floor, and also on asking to raise the ball of the toes of the forefoot as a part of the evaluation for any tendo-Achilles shortening, I did not notice it. While walking, I would like to analyze the gait, and on asking him to walk, I noticed he is not able to clear the foot from the floor and there is a drag of the toes on the floor. To compensate this, he flexes the hip and the knee, and in the swing phase, the ball of the toes precede the heel from touching on the floor. So it is a ball of the toes which touch the floor first and then the heel. He has a slapping kind of a gait. I would like to term it as a high steppage gait. Next, I would like to examine the patient in sitting position with his left leg crossed over the right knee for evaluation of the ankle joint, the details of which I shall elaborate further in the local examination. I would like to examine the patient in the supine position for the evaluation of local examination as followed in the next slide. Local examination inspection: attitude of the limb. Patient is lying supine with flexion at the knee, plantar flexion at the ankle and a slight inversion at the subtalar joint with flexion of the toes. Local examination: bulk of the leg appears normal in comparison and contrasting from the opposite contralateral right side limb. I would like to evaluate the skin if it is dry, glossy, smooth, disappearance of any cutaneous fold or subcutaneous fat, to evaluate any sympathetic nervous system involvement due to any nerve injury. I would also like to evaluate the skin for pallor, excessive sweating, which is not present in my patient. I would like to evaluate the nails if there is any ridge nails or brittle nails in as part of the trophic disturbances that is caused due to a nerve injury. And finally, I would like to examine for trophic ulcers in the limb. Local examination: I notice a 25 cm long vertical scar encompassing the middle third and the lower third of the leg. on the anterior aspect of the leg, the extent of the scar being craniocaudally, 5 centimeters distal to the distal to the tibial tuberosity, extending to the level of the malleoli inferiorly. There is also a 4 centimeter long horizontal scar at the level of the malleoli that is noted over here. The scar is healed with primary intention. The patient is unable to dorsiflex the left foot and is also unable to extend the toes of the left foot. On attempted dorsiflexion of the left foot, I noticed that there are some flickering of the muscles proximally in the anterior compartment. Also, on asking the patient to perform an inversion of the foot or reversion of the foot, it is intact and the plantar flexion also is intact. Coming to the local examination palpation, I would like to evaluate the temperature of the pertinent limb, that is the left limb, and compare it with the right side to notice if there is any change in temperature, especially being cold on the left side. I would like to assess the skin for any altered sensations. I would assess the scar for it if it is soft, supple, or if I can elicit any tenderness on that scar to notice if there is any adhesion of the nerve in that area. I would like to measure the circumference of the limb at the fixed bony points as a contrast and comparison to the opposite limb to evaluate for muscle bulk. Local examination palpation, I would like to assess the general sensations of tactile sensitivity, pain, temperature, position, and appreciation of vibration in this patient. Next, I would like to assess the sensory nerve territories over the leg and the foot of the following, that is the superficial peroneal nerve, deep peroneal nerve, plantar nerves, that is medial plus lateral, saphenous nerve, and the sural nerve. I have actually put inverted the picture of this and I put it as a stylized diagram for assessment. I'll just go to the stylized diagram. I will be checking the proximally to distally the superficial peroneal nerve area as I have highlighted it in green and the saphenous nerve area that I've highlighted in pink, the sural nerve that I've highlighted in dark green at the 4 foot lateral aspect and the two nerves which are pertinent to this case, that is the deep peroneal nerve in the first web space and the medial and lateral plantar nerves on the respective toes I've mentioned and also on the sole of the foot in the plantar nerve territory. On examination of all these nerves, it has been told to me that these sensations are all intact in all the nerve territories that I mentioned. Going next, local examination palpation, I have tested the following muscles of the patient: extensor hallucis longus, extensor digitorum longus, tibialis anterior, and peroneus tertius. All of them are not functioning in this patient. That is the anterior compartment. In the lateral compartment, I have assessed the peroneus longus and brevis with eversion and they are functioning. And in the posterior compartment, that is the deep compartment of the posterior compartment, deep musculature of the posterior compartment, I have assessed for the flexor hallucis longus, flexor digitorum longus, and tibialis posterior, and they're all functioning. My inference of this examination is that the functional deficit is restricted to only one compartment, and that is the anterior compartment in this patient. Next, coming to the muscle power, I have also done the power of the knee also, as it is the most proximal joint to the area of injury proximally. The flexion and extension is grade 5/5. When it comes to the ankle, the dorsiflexion is 0/5. The plantar flexion, eversion, and inversion are all grade 5/5 MRC grading. When it comes to the metatarsophalangeal joint, the flexion is 5/5, but the extension is 0/5. Moving forward, the range of movements when I have been checking in this patient with respect to the joint, that is the ankle joint, when I have performed range of movements for the dorsiflexion, when I asked the patient to actively dorsiflex, the patient was not able to actively dorsiflex. But on passive movement, I noticed that he has a full range of degrees at the of dorsiflexion at the ankle joint. But when I asked the patient to perform plantar flexion, eversion and inversion, all of them were active and they had full range of movements in active movements. When proceeding further to the metatarsophalangeal joint, when I asked the patient to perform a flexion, he actively performed it with full range of motion. Whereas when it came to extension, patient was not able to actively extend the toes. But when I passively extended the toes, it came out to be complete 80 degree range of motion. My inference with this test would be that the ankle joint and the metatarsophalangeal joint, both the joints have full range of passive movements, though there is no active movement, and I infer that the joints are supple. Next, local examination with respect to the distal pulsation. I have checked the anterior tibial artery, the dorsalis pedis artery, and the posterior tibial artery. The sensations are well felt. They are good in volume, rate, rhythm, and character. Next, I would like to assess the tendo Achilles for any shortening by noticing the passive range of movement at dorsiflexion, and there is no shortening noted, which actually confirms my findings in the inspection and the palpation that I have performed even before. The opposite link is normal, and also the donor sites that have flanged, if I require flax on the ipsilateral limb and the contralateral limb, have been examined and found to be adequate. Now, arriving at my diagnosis, I have taken this picture and I have actually extrapolated it to an anatomical picture. I attribute this foot drop to the events taking place at the scar, that is a horizontal scar of 4 cm in the distal one third of the leg. My explanation for the deep peroneal nerve and superficial peroneal nerve, which not being involved in this case, are as follows, as the sensations were intact given to me as a case. So the structures that are vulnerable to damage with respect to this scar, now I'm moving forward with the anatomical diagram quickly. The structures that are vulnerable to damage with respect to this scar is the tibialis anterior, the extensor hallux is longus, the extensor digitorum longus, the deep peroneal nerve, and the superficial peroneal nerve. So if I arrive at my diagnosis to confirm, if you can notice diagram number 2, there is a green color structure, that's a deep peroneal nerve, and diagram number 3, there is a green color structure, that is a superficial peroneal nerve. And if you correlate with the first diagram there, where the scar should have been there, these two nerves should have been involved in this injury, but they have not been involved in the examination. Which means, I arrive at my diagnosis, the inference that, as these sensations are intact, in spite of the level in the area of the injury, I feel that the nerves would have been repaired in the direct as a direct primary repair 6 years ago, when the open reduction internal fixation was performed, or in the last 6 years, there may have been a sensory overlap, and that is the reason why the sensations are intact today, or for a bizarre reason, it might have escaped the injury for an unknown reason. No. Coming next, with respect to the anterior compartment, with respect to the first diagram where the horizontal scar is present, these are the three muscles that have been pertinently involved in this case. Diagram number 1 is the tibialis anterior that I've highlighted in blue. Diagram number 2 is extensor hallucis longus. Diagram number 3 is the external extensor digitorum longus. Keeping these three in mind, I arrive at my diagnosis that the inference is that it is an isolated injury of the anterior compartment of the leg tendons, that is tibialis anterior, EHL and EDL. And I have shown the line of transaction that has taken place for each of these muscles and why it is causing a deficit in dorsiflexion and a deficit in the extension of the toes, respectively. So this was the picture given to me. So my diagnosis is left foot drop secondary to traumatic transaction of EHL, EDL, and tibialis. Sir, it's echoing again, sir. So may I continue?
Yeah, sir. Yes, continue.
Yes, sir. So my diagnosis is left foot drop, yes, secondary to traumatic. Transaction of EHL EDL.
Transaction of EHL EDL.
And tibialis anterior tendons.
And tibialis anterior tendons.
At distal one third of the leg.
At distal one third of the leg.
My investigations. Sir, it's echoing. Hello?
Wait. Before we go into the investigations and management, you are going to attribute everything because now there has been an injury. Am I being heard? Hello, Gautam?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. JJM, sir, you are being heard, sir.
Okay.
We can hear you.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, you are able to hear me.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, sir.
Now, your diagnosis is attributed to the, because there had been an injury, and after the injury,
yes,
the patient,
sir,
developed a foot drop. So we very well know it is because of the injury, it's post-traumatic sequelae.
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Gautam, are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir. I'm able to hear you, sir.
Post-traumatic sequelae.
Yes, sir.
Now, yes, sir. I'm able to hear you, sir.
Okay. Now,
yes, sir.
In the examination, you'll be given any case diagnosis has become, everything is pointing towards the trauma. In the case, in a case history, when you ask for history case of a foot drop where there had not been any trauma, you have missed many points in the history. What are the other things you would like to ask? This, you know, it is because of trauma. Of course, you have been given only a photograph with which you have reduced so much of clinical examination, findings and history and everything. In the case of a foot drop, what is the other history you will ask for? What you have not mentioned?
Oh, okay, sir.
Occupation, important.
It can be because of...
Should you know the occupation of the patient?
Yes, yes, sir, yes, sir. It can be
because of... No, no, you now you tell Gaurav what you want to ask.
Should you ask about occupation and how it is important in the case of a foot drop?
Yes, sir, occupation I should ask, sir. It especially if they are into a profession where they have to do tailoring, if they have to do tailoring or where they have to use their profession where they have to do tailoring.
Any occupational hazard can cause a foot drop?
Yes, sir.
Any industries?
Yes, sir. Industrial accidents can cause.
Yes, sir.
Any industries?
Yes, sir. Industrial accident.
Ma'am, I do not know, ma'am, what is this industrial accident that, I mean...
Not industrial Gaurav. Accident, anything
Gaurav.
Else.
Gaurav, Dr. JJM is asking, what are the other causes for foot drop in which, what are the occupational causes? Can you rattle out the causes?
Occupational causes? No, sir, I'm not knowing, sir. The occupational
any chemicals?
Causes.
Any chemicals?
Okay, yes, ma'am. There are chemicals that can, while working in factories, they are this one exposed to it.
What chemical can cause?
No, ma'am. I'm not getting it, ma'am. But there is an association of this nerve involvement. I'm not able to recollect. I'm sorry.
Hello.
Gaurav?
Yes, sir.
Gaurav? Yes, the videos of this? There were videos of this particular case, right?
No, sir. There was no video given to me, sir.
Oh, okay. Okay.
No video, sir. No video, Sandeep. Okay. Only video, photo. For only photo. Okay. This job we gave.
Sir, we have one video of the patient walking. We can just play it.
Gaurav, tell me about that. We are talking about this. Hello. Hello.
Tell yes, what sir. Are yes, the
what are the industrial hazards?
Sir,
so what are the poisonings that can lead to such a condition? What are the metal poisonings that can cause foot drop and a wrist drop?
Sir, I'm not able to recollect, sir. I'm sorry. The chemical component, I do not know, sir.
Okay. Yeah, okay. What are the metabolic conditions you will ask for that can cause, tell me the causes for peripheral neuropathy. Should you not exclude all this? This is a trauma case. I'm not talking about this particular case. What are the metabolic conditions you will exclude?
Yes, sir. It can be diabetes, sir. It can be thyroid disorder, where it can be a pre-tibial mixed edema. In these cases, they can have these kind of peripheral neuropathy, sir, metabolically.
Any other diseases?
Yes, alcoholism.
Alcoholism, yes, sir.
And what is the commonest condition which you get as foot drop? In our country, a case which usually comes with a foot drop, what is the most common condition in our country? We get a foot drop. In what condition?
No, sir. I do not know.
Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir. I'm able to hear you, sir.
Peripheral neuropathy will be there more.
In leprosy, ma'am. In leprosy, there's a lot of... in leprosy, that's one... Hansen's disease.
Yes.
Hello, ma'am. In Hansen's
disease, correct. So, diabetes, alcohol, you should rule out all this, because in a case, when you're presenting a case, these all should be there. Even if it is negative, you should record them. Unusually, the vitamin B1 deficiency, the beriberi can cause, of course, the other clinical features will be there, but these are the conditions which can cause the peripheral neuropathies that can cause a foot drop. Now, right, you said about the gait. Gait should be mentioned first. What is a normal gait? Molo, can you describe the normal gait?
So the normal gait has got a stance phase and a swing phase, sir. Where the stance phase is 60% of the gait cycle and the swing phase... Hello?
Yes, yes, I'm hearing. Tell me.
Yes, sir. There is a stance phase and a swing phase, sir. Ah. The stance phase is actually 60% of the gait cycle, whereas the swing phase attributes to 40% of the gait cycle. So in the stance phase, we have the first we have the heel strike, then we have the foot flat, the mid stance, heel off, toe off. And then in the swing phase, we have the acceleration, then we have the mid swing, and then we have the deceleration, sir.
In a case of a foot drop, what is the gait?
The gait is called as a neuropathic gait, sir, or a high steppage gait.
Yes. How does the patient walk?
So, sir, what happens is that in the foot drop, the swing phase is affected, sir. So, when the swing phase is affected, what basically happens is that rather than the patient, rather than the heel touching the floor of the floor first, the patient's ball of the toes touches the floor first, sir. That precedes the heel.
How does the patient compensate for that?
The patient compensates by incorporating a movement from the knee and the hip, sir. So he has to flex the knee and flex the hip, and that time only he can clear the toe off the floor. And that is why he takes a high step, sir, when he's walking.
Related to this, what you will find in what you should look for in inspection.
I do not know, sir. What to look
for? See, it is rubbing on the floor every time when the patient walks. He may, and if there is no sensation in a case of a neuropathy,
yes,
there could be some ulcers. So you should mention the negative history. There are no ulcers in the ball of the toes or in the plantar aspect of the toes. That you should mention.
Yes, sir.
And if the aversion is good.
Yes, sir. Yes,
ulcers.
Sir.
Did you mention about ulcers? Okay.
I have mentioned.
You mentioned no ulcers.
I have mentioned that I will look for trophic ulcers.
You look for trophic. That is good. Where exactly is that? Is ball of the toes. And if there's an aversion problem, in this case, there's no aversion problem. Again, yes, in the lateral aspect of the foot, that there are no ulcers. Okay,
yes, sir,
that
yes.
You mentioned. Okay, now you told about the girth of the limb is same, isn't it? Did you mention about the length of the limb? Has internal fixation been done for the fracture?
Yes, sir, they have done.
What is the surgery done for the fracture?
So it is mentioned as an open reduction internal fixation, sir.
Open reduction internal fixation. Okay. Yes. Did you look for disparity in the length of the limb?
Yes.
I have not mentioned it, sir. I have not mentioned limb length discrepancy or contrasting from the opposite limb. I have not mentioned it in the slide.
Okay. What about the girth? Did you mention about the disparity in girth?
Yes, sir. I mentioned in my inspection that it looks normal, but in the palpation, I mentioned that from fixed bony points, I will compare it from the opposite contralateral limb. I mentioned that, sir.
Okay. In the case where you expect some wasting, isn't it? If a muscle has not been lost its innervation, it could have been wasted, or it could be wasted because of disuse atrophy.
Yes,
am
sir.
I right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. In that case, what are the conditions that may cause increase in the girth?
Increase in the
girth. There is an increase in the girth. What should you suspect?
In general, you tell what are the conditions. There will be increase in the girth.
In the affected limb, in the injured limb.
Because
not related to this case. In general, if there is increase in the girth, what are the conditions you suspect in trauma case? Closed injury.
closed injury can be because if the patient had a compartment syndrome, ma'am, that's what you're asking.
Whatever may be the reason, sir. Yes.
One is that there is an edema. If there's edema, there will be increase in girth. The other one, if the fracture has not been reduced, if it's the malaligned fracture, still it could be, if there's overlapping of the fragments, there could be an increase in girth. So just because it is equal girth, it doesn't rule out an atrophy of the muscle.
Yes, sir.
There could be other reasons for the girth being maintained.
Okay, sir.
And you mentioned about examining the patient in four: standing, sitting, lying, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Did you say one more?
Walking, sir. I mentioned walking, standing, sitting, and lying down, sir.
How did you test the power of the dorsiflexion?
Sir, I had I requested the patient to cross his left leg over the right knee, and then sitting I did all my testing, sir. So one testing I did against gravity, and one I did along I did the testing against gravity, sir.
So against gravity, without gravity, and then against
resistance.
Yeah. It's not enough that you know, you should tell.
Oh, sorry, sir.
I know you tested against resistance, but you should tell. And yes, sir, you tested against resistance. Okay. How do you test? You give, you ask the patient to dorsiflex and you offer resistance. This you can do in the sitting posture as well as in the lying posture.
Lying down posture, sir.
And then what are the other joints you tested? After the ankle. Joints,
sir, I have tested the metatarsophalangeal joint in the foot.
In between.
Sir, hello?
In between the ankle and the metatarsophalangeal.
What is that? The joint.
Subtalar joint, sir. I have evaluated the subtalar joint also for inversion and eversion.
Yes. Yeah, you mentioned the equal patient is able to do actively eversion as well as inversion.
Yes, sir.
And I saw your sensory mapping, I saw that all the sensations are intact.
Yes, now, sir.
Now, based on, because you think it is a, there is no nerve injury at all, isn't it?
Yes,
you mentioned four muscles in motor examination in the leg.
Yes,
but
sir.
But you didn't mention about the muscles in the foot supplied by the deep peroneal now.
Oh, yes, sir, I did not mention, sir.
What are they?
I'm so sorry, sir, I should have added this one.
What are those muscles?
In the foot, sir, now will be
when there is an extensor digitorum longus, that should be sir. Another. What should be there in the foot?
Flexor, flexor, you're asking, sir?
No. We are on the extensor side now.
Digitorum brevis, sir. Brevis.
When there is a longus, there should be
brevis, sir.
Brevis. Extensor digitorum brevis.
Yes, sir.
And when there is a hallucis longus, there should be
brevis.
Extensor hallucis brevis.
Brevis. Yes, sir.
They are supplied by the deep peroneal nerve. In that case, if you want to know to rule out whether the nerve also has been injured or not, just above the ankle, these muscles should be active in addition to the presence of sensation.
Yes, sir.
So that is important here to know whether the nerve also has been injured or not. If it is going to be a muscle and a nerve injury, then the prognosis is going to be bad. When you do any surgery for this condition, both muscular tenderness plus nerve injury means the surgery is, the prognosis is bad. In that case, you can take other shortcuts for restoring the dorsiflexion.
Yes, sir.
So these things are important. And you told about the pulse. Pulse is what? Yes. You mentioned pulse is present.
Take it off.
Anything more you can add for the pulse?
Yes, sir. I mentioned, sir, volume, rate, rhythm. I have mentioned the characteristics that I'm supposed to see from the pulse.
Good. Now, is there any equivalent of Allen's test in the lower limbs? Yes.
I do not know, sir.
When you do borsalis pedis slap, will you do any
yes,
test?
Ma'am.
What is that test? How will you do?
What we have to do is that, ma'am, we have to actually occlude the anterior tibial artery. And then we have to check if there is a collateral supply that is coming from the posterior tibial artery, ma'am. So we can actually hold a Doppler and find out also at the same time.
What you mentioned about Doppler is the answer I wanted. Like yes, the Allen's test in the hand, it is not so easy to feel the pulse coming out immediately. So we need a Doppler in the case of a leg to see whether there is a flow.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, the Doppler. With Doppler, we can do a Allen's equivalent of Allen's test in the leg to see whether the flow is there in the peroneal and the posterior tibia when dorsalis pedis is occluded.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good. That's your answer. Now you completed the diagnosis. You think now it's only the muscle injury, isn't it? ESL, EDL, and tibial is anterior.
Yes,
transection.
Sir. Yes,
and
sir.
The patient, and you didn't mention about this to plan the management. We should also mention the duration. It's been for 6 years duration. Okay, that is going to alter your surgical plan. The duration will alter your surgical plan.
Yes, sir.
Okay, let's go. Let's see what you're going to tell about investigations and management.
Yes, sir. I'll continue, sir.
Yeah.
So my investigations will be first to confirm my findings. That is with electrodiagnostic testing and radiological evaluation. And the second set of investigations will be for pre-anesthesia checkup. With respect to electrodiagnostic testing, I would like to perform an electromyography or a nerve conduction study. Electromyography, I am doing it because in the history given, it is written that on attempted dorsiflexion of the foot, there is flickering of the proximal muscles. I want to check the adequacy of these muscles, whether they'll be powerful enough to perform the heavy activity required of dorsiflexion once the tendon repair or tendon coaptation has been performed by tendon grafts or direct repair. The nerve conduction studies I would like to perform to check the intactness of the nerve, that is both motor and sensory, and whether they may have been a motor nerve component injury during the initial 6 years back injury, if there was any injury there and that might have recovered or there is some kind of a latency that is present there in the nerve conduction study. So my nerve conduction is just to check the intactness and reconfirm the diagnosis. EMG is to check the proximal muscles. My radiological testing that I would like to perform is a X-ray of the leg apilateral because there is an implant that is still in situ in that bone. I want to check also the healing status of the bone and also rule out if there is any problem with the union of the bone in that area of the fracture site. Next is the radiological investigations that I want to perform. If the tibial implant history has been given to me that if it is MRI compatible or not, based on that, if the tibial implant that has been given to me is told that it is MRI compatible, then I will perform an MRI. But if it is given to me that it is not an MRI compatible implant, then I'll go for a high resolution ultrasonography. Either ways, I would want to check the soft tissue status, the tendon continuity, and the tendon gaps that is present over there, because this can alter my plan of management. Investigations for pre-anesthesia checkup is the blood work routines, and then I would also want to perform an ECG and a chest X-ray. With respect to management, my plan A will be tendon repair of the transected EHL, EDL and tibialis anterior tendons. But in the event after exploration, I come to know that this site for either for soft tissue equilibrium or with respect to tendon gaps are not enough, then I will immediately go for a tibialis posterior tendon transfer. So the broad treatment plan is that, sir, I'll put my patient on an ankle foot orthosis just to help him in physiotherapy and with on and off on and off the AFO quite frequently because we are taking him up for surgery. And 2 months before the actual plan of surgery, I would want to perform an isolation and strengthening of the potential donor muscle being the tibialis posterior as the backup plan if I'm not able to do the coaptation of EHL, EDL and TA. So my treatment course is basically based on the wound exploration findings intraoperatively of the distal one-third leg horizontal scar. So when I proceed, if the on wound exploration, I might come across these challenges. First of all, with respect to soft tissue equilibrium, if the fibrosis is minimal, I will go ahead with EHL, UBL, TBLS anterior repair, direct repair, or a tendon graft. But if the soft tissue equilibrium is bad and the fibrosis is very extensive, I will go for a TBLS posterior tendon. I mentioned it in red. In the green, I mentioned with respect to the proximal and the distal gap in the tendons of the EHL, EDL, and TBLS anterior. Now, if the gap is small, I'll go for a direct repair. If the gap is large, I'll go for a tendon graft. And if there's an extensive gap which cannot be bridged that well, and I know that the soft tissue equilibrium also is not good in that area, I shall bypass this area of operative site and go for a TBLS posterior tendon transfer. When it comes to the soft tissue coverage in violet color, if the soft tissue coverage after operative site I feel is adequate, then I do a primary closure of the operative site. But if I feel that the soft tissue coverage is inadequate during the surgery, then what I will do is that, since I'm doing tendon coaptation and tendon work there, I will go for a flap cover, maybe a flap cover in that area.